Welcome to the CodeCast Podcast. Real-world insights for your daily medical coding and billing processes. And now, here's your host, Terry Fletcher.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the CodeCast Podcast. My name is Terry Fletcher. We hope everyone is having a good start to your week. And this week, I have breaking news. So there's a couple of things that have been happening out there in the healthcare industry. You know, I try to bring it to your attention whenever I get an opportunity. And today is one of those days. This was an issue that came out not too long ago. And it's been on now the Department of Justice front page news, and we've had something else happen. And so I just think it's important that we have a conversation about it. It's really unfortunate, but it's something that you need to be mindful of and aware of because it really applies to any practice that has an electronic medical record software or an electronic health record software. So we want to make sure that you're understanding what's happening out there right now before something happens within your practice that you're not anticipating. So what the breaking news is that, and I'll start with what the news, I guess the news cycle reported, Greenway Health had to pay $57 million to settle claims that to satisfy EHR certification. Well, it basically said that they did not satisfy electronic health record certification requirements, and then they also had to pay the settlement because they incentivized their clients that had their software to promote their product and as certified, and they weren't. Now, we know that about, I would say maybe 6-7 months ago, we also had eClinical Works that had to pay back $155 million, and all these are filed under the False Claim Acts. And this was falsely claiming that software met the meaningful use regulations. And that was a problem because a lot of physicians, thousands of them actually, said that they were entitled to meaningful use bonuses, and they weren't. And some did get them and some didn't. It was just kind of a nightmare. And then also when Allscripts went to or agreed to buy Practice Fusion and also McKesson, then the DOG opened up investigations into those two companies, and we're now seeing that there could be even further allegations of false claims and pretending to, I hate to say the word pretending, but it's basically they're saying they're satisfying not only the certification for their electronic health record software, but they're misrepresenting the capability of the product under the False Claim Act. Athena Health is also starting to see issues, and I don't like to name names. That's not my job, but if any of you have those softwares, you know, you have to understand what you have and or what you think you have and then what's happening out there in the industry. An example would be, let's say that you have a software that says that, you know, you have an audit feature on there so that you know that certain people in your office can see certain records and other records are not for that particular employee. So an audit feature to ensure employees are not accessing records, basically meeting the need to know basis, is what is part of an electronic health record certification. So in a good system, certification compliant, so they meet the guidelines of what is supposed to be represented of the capability, you could run a report, for example, by employee to see what records they've accessed. In a bad system, you have to look at every single record, every single patient record, to see who has accessed it. That's non-compliant. And so those types of things you want to make sure that you are on top of. I don't like bringing you this breaking news information, but you need to know because those systems out there are, you know, very popular. And so you want to, even if I didn't name one of your systems that you have, I would go and take a look. You know, for anybody that has an electronic health record or an EMR, and most everybody does now, hospitals as well as physician practices, and ask them for their certification. Make sure that you get a list. What is necessary within a certification as far as the capabilities of the EMR and what your vendor is telling you it can do. And if you're a client of mine, so if you're part of our Coding Corner client, we actually can find that out for you. If you're a non-client, you're just a podcast listener, which we appreciate you as well, make sure you do go to the DOJ and their website and also Medicare, and you'll need to search it out to find out what those lists of capabilities are, what you need to have for that certification, so that you know that you're meeting your requirements and that they're not falsifying those certificates. So good luck with that, but I want to make sure that you knew there's some settlement actions out there, and it's just, I mean, what EHR can you trust at this point? This is what's really unfortunate when I see that, because I also refer to different EHR plans, and I get people all the time, clients and anybody who's taken a webinar or a seminar of mine, or I've been, you know, in their practice doing any kind of consulting, and I get a lot of practices saying, well, Terry, do you like this system? We're thinking of changing to this system. What do you think? And so I'm, you know, I want to be mindful that I know what systems out there are telling the truth and are, you know, certified, and make sure that they can follow not only meaningful use, but HIPAA, and have those features on there that are necessary under that certification. And then we're going to trend. So there's something that I wanted to bring to your attention as well. And this next topic is, it's kind of fun for me, because I know that I've done a couple of podcasts, and I'll continue to do them, on revenue opportunities. But I wanted to do this one called Can I Code for That? Because every once in a while, I will be in a meeting or I will hear somebody say, well, you can't do that. And I love when I hear that, because then I'm like, well, you think you can't do that? Let's take a look. So I always like to see, okay, well, let's see. And sometimes you can't. But there's, when I do hear that sometimes, I want to say, well, let's see. I don't always want offices to be told they can't unless you have it in writing and you absolutely know black and white you cannot do it. So one thing that comes up on Can I Code for That? Would be something that you would see in the CPT book, and it is a procedural code that has in parentheses under the code description, and it says separate procedure. So traditionally, a lot of coders feel that you cannot code for anything that says separate procedure, because it is inclusive of any larger procedures, or I should say more extensive procedures, within that encounter. And that is accurate, except first, you must consider and identify other procedures performed during the same encounter. You can always identify a designated procedure by the inclusion of the separate procedure parenthetical language at the end of a code description. So let's take a look at a orthopedic example. So 29830, that's an arthroscopy elbow diagnostic, with or without synovial biopsy, and at the very end of that code, it says separate procedure. So a separate procedure designation identifies that a procedure may be performed independently or as part of a more extensive procedure, depending on the circumstances. Also, CPT surgery guideline says some of the procedures or services listed in the CPT codebook are commonly carried out as an integral component of a total service or procedure that has been identified by the inclusion of the term separate procedure. These codes are designated and should not be reported in addition to a code for the total procedure or service, which it's considered an integral component of. Okay, that makes sense. So what this means in plain language, if a separate procedure is performed during a more extensive procedure in which it is typically included, it is not separately reported. So whenever I hear somebody say it can never be coded, that's what they're referring to. But then there's a second one. It says, if a procedure is performed alone or with another procedure of which it is typically not a part of, it may be separately reported. So for example, that 29830 may be reported by itself to describe or designate a diagnostic scope of the elbow, but it's not separately reported or reimbursed with another arthroscopic procedure in the same elbow. So let's say that we also removed a foreign body, 29834. Well, then we would not code the separate procedure and also the foreign body removal. And then we also have to look at CCI edits. So CPT doesn't provide a complete list of codes which have the separate procedure and that may be bundled unless you have a full clinical understanding of the procedure performed. How can you know for certain whether a separate procedure is truly separate? So that's when you have to go to your NCCI, which is the National Correct Coding Initiative, And what that does, these are edits that your payer follows, saying that these are inclusive of other services. It's a Medicare function, but the CCI EDIP has a lookup tool in your billing software typically, and you can also get it on the Medicare website. But when we look at these services, NCCI edits are also not absolute. So even if designated separate procedure triggers an NCCI edit, you may be able to report the separate service if, and this is where I can code for that. So this is where you have to make sure that you know the rules. And I mentioned this in the last podcast, really understanding the rules and following up on that. So if the NCCI code pair edits include a one modifier indicator, okay, everybody has an indicator on NCCI edits. So one, they have one indicators, zero indicator means it's never reported together, but a one modifier indicator means that it may be reported separately and reimbursed from the column one side if the second condition is also met. So the separate procedure must truly be separate, and that condition must be identified with that 59 modifier, possibly an X modifier, but we'll talk about that another time, to determine that it's a distinct procedural service. And I would also recommend that you have a separate diagnosis. So what this talks about is that when a service or procedure that is designated as separate procedure is considered to be unrelated or distinct from other procedures or services provided at the time, it may be reported in addition to the other procedures or services by appending the modifier 59 to a separate procedure code as indicated. But you have to make sure that it's distinct, it's separate, it's independent of the original procedure. That may represent a different session, a different procedure at surgery, again, a different organ system, a separate incision, separate lesion, completely different. And this is part of the CPT surgery guideline. This is where this is outlined. So an example, if you check NCCI edits, you'll know that 29830, and we're going back to our elbow arthroscopy. So 29830 is bundled into 29834, which is for more extensive service, but a modifier allows the code pair edit that has a one. So in that circumstance, it says that you may be able to code both of them together. So for example, if the diagnostic scope and the surgical scope were performed on separate elbows, maybe 29830 may be reported separately with a 59 modifier because it represents a separate anatomical location. You could also apply the modifier either LT or RT for right or left side of the body. And then both the 29834 and also 29830 could be performed together. But do you see, you have to make sure that there is a specific designate. It can't be something, let's say, on the same laterality, same side, that would be extensive to the original procedure. But if you're on opposite sides or a completely different incision or different service, then you may be able to code for it. So make sure that when you're asking yourself that question, can I code for this, that you read all the guidelines and look at it from a specific standpoint of not only CCI edits, but also your diagnosis at that point. So my next, can I code for that? Here's one that comes up actually pretty frequently in some of the things that I do around when it comes to talking about meet and greet visits. So what is that? Well, potential patients may ask for a meet and greet visit with the physician. So these visits can be compared pretty much like an interview because the patient's main goal is to learn more about the physician to be sure they will receive quality care or that they're comfortable. But it may not be a complete E&M or evaluation and management visit that needs to have the patient completely worked up. So we know how valuable the physician's time is, but how can the physician be paid for their time with these types of visit? If there's no medical reason for the visit, it really is just a meet and greet, then this is where it's going to be tough because there's no legitimate claim to be submitted to the insurance company. And so can you code for this? Yes, but it is a patient out-of-pocket expense. So meet and greet visits would have to be paid out-of-pocket by the patient because there's no billing medical necessity is what we're talking about. Now, preventative services, that's always an option, but they do not require a chief complaint, and sometimes insurance reimburses for them. But meet and greet visits really don't qualify as a preventative service because they would not include the age and gender appropriate history exam and counseling and anticipatory guidance that usually is required on the components of a preventative visit. But what would you think a meet and greet would be? So a meet and greet would be, and I had to do this actually when my daughter was younger, and that would be a pre-birth pediatrician visit. You call a doctor's office, a pediatrician's office, because you want to figure out who your, you know, baby doctor is going to be. And they basically say, we don't do that. A lot of offices don't. But if you say, well, I'm willing to pay $100, or I'm willing to, you know, come to, you know, really talk to the physician. When are you on call? What are my options? What do I do with this or that? And you want to get comfortable with the physician. I did that. And I paid that money. And I was happy that I did it. Also, when you're talking about a meet and greet, it would be also a screening. So let's say you're somebody that is considering a screening colonoscopy. Well, screening colonoscopy pre-visits are not paid or by your insurance company. Well, traditionally, they're definitely not paid by Medicare. Some payers might pay them, but if somebody in your doctor's office is saying that you can bill this with an E&M service, that would be incorrect. Because remember, evaluation and management services are for problem-oriented services where you have a chief complaint. But if you're saying this is a screening, there is no chief complaint. They're basically the patients coming in because they're age appropriate for a procedure. And so when it comes down to it, these are really kind of what we call non-medical visits. And they're meet and greet to show potential patients why they want to keep your physician. And if your practice decides that they want to charge for it, just be clear on your expectations of the patient, of the payment, how much it is, when they're expected to pay it, and also that it applies to all the patients for the same like services. So, you know, sometimes you charge for filling out forms, copying medical records, and everything like that, but you have to consider charging for a meet and greet when it is your physician's time. And so when some people say, no, you can't charge for that, it's like, well, you technically can. And, you know, patients need to understand that if your physician is going to take the time and they want their time to consider them as their provider, then that's something they may have to pay out of pocket. So can you code for that? Can you charge for that? Yes. Can you bill for it? Not necessarily. Now, the other one, and this is the last one I'm going to bring up today. I actually had five, but I'm going to stick with this one because the other ones are a little bit complicated, and I may dedicate one of them to really understanding how to dissect your CPT book on can you bill for something. But this one is smoking cessation and the 99406 and 407 codes. As I've mentioned on previous podcasts, I audit my head off. I am just such a big auditing person right now, and it's interesting when I audit because I have so many patients that on the medical records that are smokers, or they're patients that are trying to quit. Okay, so they're a current smoker and have current issues with regard to their smoking habits. And a lot of doctors will say something like, you know, lengthy discussion with patient on the benefits of quitting smoking, and they don't charge anything extra, which they shouldn't. But let's just take that a step further. If that doctor would have said, lengthy discussion of 6-7 minutes with the patient on the benefits of quitting smoking due to, let's say it was a GI patient, due to the inflamed colon area that we need to address, and this is now causing complications of that, or the patient's a COPD patient and they have breathing issues, and so they're saying, we've asked the patient several times to quit smoking and we're going to have a more serious conversation at her next visit, and we spent 10 minutes discussing this. That's the 99406 and 99407 codes. And I bring this up not just because of how much I see it in the auditing, where just one extra statement by the physician of time would allow you an extra code, but Medicare and some of the private payers now allow it without a copay and a deductible to the patient. And it's such an important topic to talk to the patient about, especially if they're not going to have an out-of-pocket. If you just say lengthy discussion, you don't get it. But if you actually put in how much time was dedicated to that particular discussion, then yes, you can code for it. So really keep that in mind. In addition to an office visit, you don't even need a modifier. So they're allowed about 4 a year. That's Medicare. And it's not just 4 per physician. It's 4 per patient. So if some other physician is billing for it, you may see a denial here and there. But you just need to know that you can code for that and capture it as long as your documentation can support it with time. So now it's time for our coding question. And today our coding question talks about renal angiography and stenting. So the question comes from one of my clients up in Alaska and says the patient has previously undergone a diagnostic angiography, which confirmed a 90% stenosis of the right renal ostium. So that's the opening. Today, the patient presents to the peripheral vascular lab for stenting of the right renal lesion. The procedure note reflects a selective catheter placement into the right renal artery, followed by stent placement and the post-procedure film to evaluate potential dissection. How would you code this scenario? Can you also include modifiers for us? So here's something that comes up quite a bit, and I've seen offices miss this. And so your code would be the 37236. So that is a stent with angioplasty, and it's with or without angioplasty, actually. But in the renal area, it does not include a cath placement. And so your cath placement only would be, it's a first order selective off the aorta. So it'd be 36245. You need a 59 modifier because there is a bundling edit. I mentioned the CCI edits before. And a question always comes up is, well, what about 36251? Because that's renal angiography with cath placement. Well, the 36251 code is for a diagnostic renal angiography, meaning that you're looking for a problem. That was already done. And so now you get paid for your extra cath placement because in this area anatomically, whenever you do this stenting and the angioplasty, the payer will actually pay for an additional cath placement. It's not the same on different anatomical sites, so we're just talking renals right now. And so you default to the 36245 instead of using a code that's inclusive of angiography. And you'll notice in my example, it said in a post-procedure film to evaluate dissection. Well, you can't code to check your work. So if there was a dissection, would I code for it? Maybe. But because you're just saying, how did the stent and how did the angioplasty work? That's not something you can code for. Only if there is a symptom problem that leads to a diagnostic test that leads to the intervention, which is what we have. So in that coding scenario, it would be 37236, 36245 with a 59 modifier. And our coding question today is brought to you by ICD-10 Monitor, icd10monitor.com. Read my current article on new and established patients, and are you capturing the right code or losing revenue? icd10monitor.com. So as I was going through some of this information, I just wanted to speak to the administrators and the billing managers out there, and really anybody who's in the hiring process for coding and billing and collection staff. What I would do is I would think outside the box when you create your team. It's one thing to be certified, which, I like to have certified coders. Absolutely. I am an advocate for it. But when you're looking at your complete team, especially your cleanup crew, which are your collection and appeals, staff and the process, pick staff who are willing to take chances without sacrificing compliance, who look for trends, and who continually look for process improvements and revenue opportunities. So for example, when I do an audit, I make sure that I highlight an area when I think a patient could benefit from chronic care management. If I see a patient, for example, I mentioned the smoking cessation, if I see a physician that hasn't put in the time, I will speak to that physician and say, hey, look, you need to make sure the time's there so that we can capture that next time. Several practices use my service and myself and my coding staff to code their records for them. So a lot of times cardiology, I have one practice that's gastro, another two of them that are ortho, 12 that are cardiology. And basically they just say code for us. We don't want to do it or we don't have the staff to do it. And I notice that I don't just code and send them the spreadsheet and say, here are your codes. I code for them, but I also, when I'm reviewing the reports, because they send and scan the reports to me, I say, okay, by the way, I also want to capture the moderate sedation, but your doctor needs to say under my supervision. Then I can capture it because you have the time, the medicine, and the rest of the statement. Or I'll say, hey, I noticed the physician is giving a lot of angiographic data on the lower extremities, but I can't find the cath placement within the report detail. So can they be more specific on where that catheter is placed and what they injected so I know if it's diagnostic or if it's just a drive-by incidental because we want to capture it. Those are the kinds of staff members that you want in place so that you can make sure that your team is out, not just for the physician, but for your processes, for your reimbursement, and that you can count on them and that they can be independent workers as well. Because eventually, and go back and listen to my podcast, people are going to want to be remote coders at some point or have that option at least one day or a couple days a month. And you want to be able to count on these people that can think outside the box. So when creating your team, think of those things. And I think that will, you know, definitely help you when you're looking at your employees and how to do things. Everybody just sometimes just goes for standard people that are out there. And nowadays, you want to be ahead of everybody else and get those people that really are, you know, hungry for a job. They know what it takes and they have your back. So really take a look at that when in your hiring processes. So I always like to give a personal tidbit. And today, I know some people have asked me recently, with hopefully spring break coming up, I heard the groundhog did not see their shadow. So I guess we're going to have, did they see their shadow or didn't see their shadow? Either way, we're supposed to have an end to this cold weather and an early spring. I hope we are getting that, because I'm so over the rain, I can't even tell you. And I love rain, but still. But if you're coming to California during a spring break, one place I would recommend that you go would be the Queen Mary for brunch down in Long Beach. Today, as I'm recording this morning, we went there for actually my music producer, DeSasson's birthday. So happy birthday to him. And it was seriously fabulously ridiculous. That's the only way I can describe it. I only was able to go up two times. We had, you know, kids with us and a big party, but it was, I missed a whole side and a whole side of the restaurant and a whole down the middle of the room. And it was absolutely ridiculous. Seriously, you won't be sorry. You have to spend at least 2 hours there, but it was crazy. And one of the things that's really funny, as we were walking in and checking in at the check-in desk, there was a trainer there with a live owl. Yes, a 2.5-foot live owl that I got to pet. I petted an owl today. How is that? So it was just very fun. So if you're ever looking for something in the Southern California area to do, please hit me up. Let me know if you're ever out here. And I'm happy to let you know what's good. So everyone, thank you for joining me today. Make it a great day. And thank you for joining us on the CodeCast podcast.
For more information on medical coding, billing, auditing, and compliance, including how to hire Terry, follow Terry on Twitter at TerryCoder1 or visit her website at www.terryfletcher.net. Podcast producer Joe Kuzma. Music producer DeSasson Music.